Mr. Rick Worthy. He's been a close friend of mine for almost 30 years now. And while I have known him personally, his face may be familiar to you as well. During this span, Rick has appeared in over 65 different TV and featured films as an actor. You may have seen him as Nathan Jackson in the TV western The Magnificent Seven with Eric Close and Ron Perlman. Or as Chris Didion in the crime series Eyes, alongside actors Tim Daly and Garcelle Beauvais. Most recently, he's the rebel freedom fighter, Lim Washington, in the two-time Emmy Award-winning Amazon series, The Man in the High Castle. And he's also in the popular sci-fi cable network series, The Magicians, where he is the determined and mysterious Dean Fogg. Regardless of the role, Rick seems to always bring a sense of heart, passion, and authenticity to his work. He was able to spend some time with us and share his thoughts on the current state of the industry and give some insights on his various roles and what it means to be an actor. Soulivity Magazine presents Rick Worthy, the Dean of Magic.
Well, you seem to be doing pretty busy yourself right now, sir.
Man, it's a blessing, man. These last 2 years have been really, really busy. Really busy, and you know that's how I like it to be, you mm-hmm. know. And like the previous year was, I would say right before probably 2013 was a really tough year, and there was not a lot going on, and I had actually considered maybe retiring, you know. And I was like, you know what, I put in enough years. Let me just kind of gracefully exit, you know.
Right, right.
And I'm glad I didn't, man. I was talking to a buddy of mine. He said, no, man, you need to really, you know, just hang in there, you know, and things will turn around, you know. It's a very cyclical business, and you know, you're mm-hmm. up, it's like a roller coaster. You're
right,
up, you're down, you're up and down.
Well, I mean, you're like one of the folks that's riding this wave right now. I mean, you've got the Magicians
yeah.
going on, you got
yeah.
the Man in the High Castle going on.
Yeah.
I mean, it's really happening, man. I mean,
it's happening, really, man. You know, it's nice to be, you know, almost 50 and be working so much.
Right, you know, right, right, you know, exactly.
One of the wonderful things about TV is that, you know, it's really our campfire. It's our modern mm-hmm. day campfire, you know, mm-hmm. how we sit around the fire and tell stories, you know. Mm-hmm. And you remember when you come over to the house, you know, my dad be sitting around the TV and my mom. Or my
exactly.
brother, you know, everyone,
exactly.
You know, that's everything socializes. Everyone seems to socialize around that modern campfire, so to speak. But the model has shifted because of the advent of this thing called the internet.
Right.
And
right.
you know what I mean? And I was one of these sort of dinosaur kind of dudes. I was just like, nah, that's never going to work, man. No one's going to watch TV through the internet, you know, this Netflix thing. No one's going to really do that. And lo and behold, that's what most people that I know do. And I do that myself. Now I watch everything I watch is either through Netflix or Hulu or Amazon Prime. And, you know, like I even watch CNN on through Yahoo or on YouTube.
Exactly.
So, you know, like everything has shifted. And because of that, and it's been so many, I think, more opportunities for people to work, particularly people of color.
Right.
And that has been a wonderful thing because it's expanded. Like, I don't have to be, you don't have, you know, typically NBC, CBS, you know, Fox, the typical, you know, networks, you have to sort of, you know, be in that 20s range and, you know, look a certain way and all that. And you know, I think for a while I was there in that sort of demographic, but just a short
right.
period.
Right, right.
And
right.
now, you know, I'm an older guy, and I've been blessed to be able to find work on, you know, on Amazon Prime with Man in the High Castle, and The Magicians is on the Sci-Fi Channel, which
right.
is, you know, cable network.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, that's a blessing, you know, and so much of it is, you know, is because of the internet, I believe, and also science fiction is just a great opportunity for people to work, man. I mean, you know, it's just not just people of color, but you know, older folks, you know
right.
what I mean?
Like, right.
I it's a blessing to see someone on set who's 65 and, you know, they've been working 50 years. You know?
Right.
So
right.
I love that. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, do you think that, the internet is playing a role in the expansion of the marketplace? It seems like
right.
Before all of this happened, you know, the route was maybe you were on TV and then you would go to the big screen. You know, you go to major films and feature films. But it seems now that, you know, like Netflix is producing an abundant number of feature films. I mean, you know, I mean, there was one I just saw that was just released the other day that I didn't even know about, but it's there. Amazon Prime is another example. So you think the marketplace has expanded, which also expanded the number of opportunities for folks?
Absolutely. I think you hit it right on the nail. I think that the marketplace has expanded. And, you know, Amazon doesn't have to answer to Kellogg cereal company.
Like
they are their own self-contained business, you know, and so if they want to, you know, kick out, you know, $80 million to do a movie, they can do it. And for them, that's not a big deal, you know.
Right.
I mean, it's a big deal, but it's for a studio to do that, they have to, they're going to hire Tom Cruise, they're going to hire Will Smith, they're going to hire bankable people.
Right.
Who they know can get, you know, they'll get their money back some kind of way.
Right.
In DVD sales or, you know, airplanes, whatever. And with the internet and Amazon, they don't have to hire someone like Will Smith or Tom Cruise. They can hire someone who's not necessarily a quote unquote star.
Right.
But they can deliver. They can do the job, you know. And I think a great example of that is the TV series I've been hooked on lately is this show called Stranger Things.
Yeah.
And man, God, it's so good. It's creepy and it's dark and, you know, all the stuff that I love. And it stars this little girl who's maybe 12 years old and no one's ever heard of her.
Right.
And man, she's so talented, bro. Like, I think she's from England, but she does an American accent perfectly. Mm-hmm. And, you know, like that's so cool that she has this opportunity, you know, to carry a major TV production, you know, and, you know, it's not Jennifer Aniston, it's this girl doing this. You know,
right.
I think that's fantastic. You know?
Well, you know, I noticed that some accomplished actresses and actors, or I should just say actors, like Taraji, for example, on Person of Interest, right? She moved from the large screen doing certain films that are geared toward the Black community and then went to Person of Interest. And a lot of people were kind of scratching their head, but then it's a hit show.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And then she's able to flip that and go to another, you know, I mean, and now she's doing, you know, the other series that's there and doing other films and that kind of thing. And I guess that goes to what you're talking about. Let's talk about the man in the high castle. Really cool. I mean, I've been watching it off and on, you know, over the last couple of years. Very, very cool concept of an alternate reality around, you know, what if Nazi Germany had won, right?
Exactly.
And
you know, which is, and I have to, if I can just quickly interject, I'll be honest with you, I had no, like, when I read it, I was like, I had actually never even really thought of that. Like, you know what I mean? Like,
right.
They could actually have won, you know? And I think that flipped me out, you know, like I was just like, whoa, because, you know, we have grown up, you know, with the reality that we know, which is that the Allied or the Axis of Evil lost and the Allied powers won, you know, so, you know, but to reverse it, I honestly had never thought of that.
Yeah. I mean, it was, you know, and I know Ridley Scott was originally one of the producers and creators of the 4-part miniseries, right? I think it was just supposed to be a 4-part miniseries in the beginning, and then it converted over.
You know what? That's actually a really good question. Ridley Scott is definitely one of the, you know, it was definitely one of his projects.
Right.
Men in
High
Castle, from what I understand, was initially it was a combination of Ridley Scott, Issa Hackett, who's Philip K. Dick's daughter.
Yes. Yeah.
And, you know, of course, it's based on the Philip K. Dick novel, The Man in the High Castle, which I had never read, actually. I'm a huge fan of Philip K. Dick, but I had never read that one. A couple of other executive producers, you know, tried to get the project going, and then it finally got up and going because Amazon decided to give it a chance, you know. So I think they shopped it around maybe for a few years, but it was too hot of a and too controversial, you know, you got swastikas, and, you know, things like that. And,
right.
You know, people don't want to touch. They don't want to touch that, man. They're like, it's too dangerous, you know. And so finally, Amazon said, okay, yeah, you know, we'll give you the money to do the pilot, and that was 2 years ago.
Right. And you get cast as Lim Washington.
Yeah.
Which is like so cool, you know. Resistant, part of the resistance. And
right.
What? Tell us about Lim. Tell from your perspective. Tell us about that character.
Well, you know, I had I can tell you what I love about. I remember when I went in to audition for the role, I had a cold, man. I had a really bad cold that day.
Oh,
and
man.
Yeah, man. And my agent called me, and I think I had already had 3 or 4. Like a brother needed to book something soon. Let's put it that way.
Okay.
And
gotcha.
my agent had sent me out on, I think, 3 auditions that week, and then I got this really crazy cold at like on a Thursday afternoon or something, and then mm-hmm. it got worse by the night, and then she called me like Thursday night and said, I have a great audition for you tomorrow. It's this Philip K. Dick adaptation, and it's Ridley Scott's producing it, and I was like, oh, man, I have to go to this audition, and, you know, because I know it's going to be good, you know. So
mm-hmm.
I read the script that night, and then I thought it was just fantastic, and Lim was, kind of like one of these guys who, like you, one of these characters that you don't really know really who he is. Like, he's so mysterious.
Gotcha.
You don't know if he is a double agent for the Japanese Empire, or mm-hmm. perhaps even the Nazis. You know, you just don't know. And it turns out he is part of the resistance movement. But we don't know, like, who he is. Some people even thought that maybe he was the man in the high castle.
Really? Wow.
And like, they just didn't know, like, who he was, you know. You know, he runs a diner in someplace in Colorado, and, you know, mm-hmm. he did Cannon City, Colorado, and he, you know, he unbeknownst to people, I know this, but no one knows this in the audience who watches the show, but, you know, Lim has a shotgun right underneath the counter of the diner.
Like, yeah, you can come up here if you want to.
Yeah,
with this,
yeah.
But I got something for you.
I got something for you, badass. Especially if you don't have the right, if you don't have the right password or whatever. You know, it's that sort of Cold War tension that I thought was really attractive about the script and about the character. You know, like, there's, you know, he has secrets. You know,
mm-hmm.
and mm-hmm. So that's, and everyone does. Everyone has secrets, and everyone's protecting something. So I thought that was the draw, man, and it was only 4 or 5 lines in the pilot, but my agent said if I booked it, they would give me like another 3 episodes, and I said I would love to do it. So I ended up getting it, and we shot it in outside of Seattle, and like a whole year went by, and they finally put it on air, and you know, we had no idea if anyone would like it or not. We hoped they would, and turned out it was the most watched show ever on Amazon Prime, in terms of like a 1-hour drama, and they decided to give it a season 2, which has just was released Friday of this week.
Right.
So
right.
Yeah, and I have been. It's funny we're talking because I actually just finished binge watching season 2. I started Friday evening and I finished Saturday morning.
Now, do you usually go back and watch your own work, or are you one that kind of shies away from it?
You know what, man? Everyone has a different approach to that, and I get so sort of emotionally close to, you know, to the role, and mm-hmm. that I usually need a year or a long time, you know, a few months before I even really sort of look at it objectively.
Right.
But I did watch it Friday night because we had been waiting for months to see anything. You know, you film something as an actor, and then you never get a chance to see anything until it airs.
Exactly.
Unless they do a premiere or a screening at somebody's house. Maybe the producer or director have a screening at their house,
mm-hmm.
or, you know, something, you know, at or local facility somewhere. But sometimes that doesn't always happen. So I usually find myself sort of waiting. And then when it's on, you know, I'm watching it at home like everybody else. And I say, hey, all right, I'll get some Spanish wine and get some pizza, and, you know, I'm going to watch it.
That sounds like a good plan to me.
Yeah.
You know?
And, you know, it's sort of like the simple things that, you know, as I've gotten older, I realize it really is the simple things that are the simple things that it really bring me a lot of joy, you know. So
Now,
I enjoyed it. I really enjoyed it, and I thought it was well done. And I really hope that I think from what I understand, the reviews have been pretty good. So that we don't know if we're going to go to season three. I just hope that we do, and we'll know probably, I think, at the end of January or something.
Right, because you'll get the terms of response and that kind of thing from the initial.
Right.
Gotcha. Right. Now, speaking of emotional roles, has there been any role that you've played where you didn't go back because you were like, no, it was too much and I can't go back and watch it?
Yeah, man. I played, I think when I hit 35, I started playing dad figures and father figures.
Wow.
You're like a real life dad. I've never been a real life. So like I've been playing dad. I played a dad on CSI Miami, and it was pretty disturbing because this is how the CSI shows are about who did the murder, the homicide,
right,
who
right.
did it, and how did they do it. Yeah.
Right.
So, I played this father whose teenage daughter, quote unquote, accidentally slipped down a flight of steps.
Oh. Okay.
But yeah, and it looks like she was pushed.
Okay.
And because my fingerprints are on her neck, when they play back the video, they sort of replay the video in the character's mind. She wasn't actually pushed; she fell. But my character was trying to catch her. And
wow.
it looked like she was pushed instead of trying to be caught. So they thought that he killed his daughter. But okay, so the evidence proved that he actually didn't do it, and they proved that it was an accident. But what got really creepy was that the character that I played was so afraid to tell his wife and tell anyone what happened, and so he hid the body in the wine cellar.
Oh, and, God. Okay. So, yeah, I can see why you wouldn't go back and watch that.
Yeah. And, I was like, well, I don't know if I really, I'm not going to put that on my demo tape. I'll have to know that one. Yeah.
Wow, man. So, Now it's getting close to next month. The new season of The Magicians gets released.
I
rarely say this. I'm a fan.
Well, thank you, man.
You like
the show. You like this. I didn't. Well, we haven't spoken in 20 years. I mean,
exactly.
I'm kind of hoping that you would be like a science fiction person.
Dude, I'm sitting in front of on my bed right now. I'm doing this interview with you, and I've got a list of things that I've already seen you in. The Star Trek stuff. I've been watching your career, brother, and been sending you vibes and of success and all that kind of stuff. A lot of people out here may not know that your career goes beyond just the sci-fi stuff, which is fantastic, but to the Magnificent Seven, which has now been reproduced in a movie, to, you already mentioned CSI Miami, but CSI NCIS, Supernatural, the Vampire series, great roles for you on Battlestar Galactica. Your path has been really wonderful. I know it's been some ups and downs here and there, but I remember recently we talked a little bit about this, about Duplicity.
Right.
And this is a funny story. And so I'm working in Germany, and I'm on the plane coming back to the United States.
Right.
They have the films, right? I put it. I'm like, oh, Duplicity. Let me check this out. On the screen, here's Rick Worthy, my boy. I've been knowing for 20 years. And I'm like trying to look for people on the plane. Like, this is my friend.
Where were you? Okay, first of all, were you coming back from Germany?
I was coming back from Europe, coming back to the U.S. And you know, it's a 7-hour flight, and you do movie things and all that kind of stuff.
Oh, I love that. I just love the picture you painted. That's my jam. I would go to Europe, man. And one of my favorite things is to be anywhere, really. You know, and just like yourself, I have a feeling you're like it. Like, we have become travelers, and I just love that.
It was funny because in that movie specifically, there was a lot of you in that movie, in that character, in Dale. I said, wait a minute, that's Rick. I mean, yeah, he's playing character, but that's Rick.
I love simplicity. It was, I would say that, you know, I haven't done many movies, you know, many films. I'm mostly theater and television, you know, and I did a lot of theater, and I did some in Detroit, and then did a lot in Chicago, and then I moved and a little bit of TV, and then I moved to LA, and I started doing a lot of TV, you know, after a couple of years,
right?
Science fiction and, you know, cop roles and things like that. So, you know, when a movie comes along for me, you know, like it's a true blessing, and I hope that it's a role that's fun, and, you know, I hope that the people who are starring in it aren't, you know, jerks, you know,
like
all these things you worry about,
right?
You know? And everybody was really nice, man. Julie Roberts, Clive Owen, Paul. Diamati, yeah, and you know, like, they were also terrific, and
that was an ensemble cast of folks.
It truly was truly an A-list group of folks, yeah. It's cool to be on a movie like that, but I think one of the things that I quickly realized was that, you know, the level of power that's involved. You know, for example, if Julia wanted to just, you know, take off for a little bit, it was cool.
Wow.
but she was really professional. I mean, she was just and very funny in between shots. She would try to make us all laugh and everything, and we would do these acting exercises together. Like, she was
really? Wow.
Yeah. But she, you know, I mean, she is, you know, a bona fide worldwide, you know, movie star, and, you know, everything sort of revolved around her.
Right.
It's funny, also really her film. I think the thing about that film was that it gave me about 10 weeks in New York City, which I love. My brother and his wife live there, so I was able to see them and my nephews. And also, I did the movie. We shot that in the winter, and it was extremely cold, brother. I mean, I'm talking cold. I was in Brooklyn on day one.
Now, that is so weird, because the one of the opening scenes was later on, Clive Owen and Julia Roberts' characters, they meet in the bar. And they're talking, and it's like they're acting like it's spring, weren't they?
Maybe they came
in later, or you guys shot at a different time, or
I think it could have been. I mean, it was filmed over a course of typically 12 weeks, I guess, would be an average time for a big, you know, big sort of film like that.
Right, right.
And I came in. I can't remember exactly when I came in. How long they had already been shooting, but I was there for maybe 9, maybe 8 weeks.
Okay.
And, but I had to, you know, get wardrobe and get find a place to live. And so I came in like a week early, you know, like you have to sort of prep for everything.
Right, right, right.
And I had to, quickly find a place to live, which I did. I literally found a place to live like the day before I got on the airplane.
Wow.
And it was really cool. Yeah. This is before, you know, you can put an Airbnb app on your phone or anything. I just had to scramble, man. So I called anyone I could think of who, you know, maybe knew someone who was renting a place, and I finally found a place. Mm-hmm. But long story short, it was cold, but I was happy to be there.
And, right.
You know, and it was right around my, I just remember it was right around, I think, my 40, first birthday. Mm. And it was, the timing was great, you know. So I was like, hey, this is my birthday present. I'm on a big film, and hopefully it'll go great. It was a bumpy shoot. I clashed with the director a few times, and it was just one of those strange, like, we just, it wasn't like we disliked each other. I just, you know, it was just, you know, he wanted a certain thing, you know, and,
right.
and you know,
right.
I just had to sort of kind of give him, you know, as best as I could what he wanted.
Right.
But
right.
I said, hey, you know, I'm in New York, but I can't complain.
Exactly. Exactly. And you get to hang out with Julia Roberts.
Yeah.
All right. So with the time remaining, I got to get to The Magicians. Because, again, first season blew my mind. I had never, and you know how discriminating I am around different, you know, I haven't changed when it comes to that.
Around the
development of the characters, but in a way that it keeps you engaged, right?
Right.
Where there's this air of kind of mystery and intensity. And so opening scene. You're on the bench in the park waiting on. Yeah. I mean, and from that, it's like, okay, what the hell is going on?
Right.
Yeah. And you guys are talking and that's still, there's still some pieces there that are still unraveling around. Mm-hmm. Okay. The story, you know, I know you can't go into much because I know this is good. Right. It's going to play out more in season two. But you got a sense that, okay, there's some desperate times going on and we got to get, you know, and it's been great, man. So tell me about your experience on The Magicians and about The Dean.
Well, thank you for asking me about it because it really is very dear to my heart. And I wanted to work on The Magicians for two reasons. The script was great.
Right.
Just great, you know. And I was like, man, and I love science fiction. You know, I love fantasy.
Mm-hmm.
And it was really three reasons. The script was great. I love the genre. And then the third reason was Sarah Gamble, who wrote the script, and she's the showrunner. It's her series.
Mm-hmm.
She exec produces it with John McNamara.
Mm.
And John and Sarah are old friends of mine. Like I knew John hired me to be on the TV show back when I was 37, 36 years old, called Eyes. It was on ABC.
Oh,
and it was a very, very cool series about these private eyes, you know, for hire, and private contractors, and Tim Daly was the lead, and Garcelle, Beauvais was in it. I was in it, and AJ Langer, and I can't remember Natalie Z. Mm-hmm. We had a really solid group of actors, and long story short, that was John's show. It was on ABC, and it lasted for like, just they pulled it fast. Like, it only aired maybe seven episodes, and we shot, I think, 20 episodes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and they pulled it off the air, man, and it just shattered me, dude. It broke my heart.
Wow.
And at the time, I was, at that time, you know, I handled things much differently than I do now. Like, the series was canceled, I got into a strong state of depression, and I was just sort of quiet and, you know, kind of missing an action for a long time, you know. And my agent said, you know, you have to drag yourself up, get out, and just get back to living life, you know. Mm-hmm. So I did.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, things turned around. But long story short, John and Sarah was a writer on the show. She was a staff writer. And then flash forward to, you know, 10, 12, 15 years later, she and John are partnering up and doing all these really wonderful things. One of them is Aquarius with David Duchovny.
Right.
And the other one was this cool fantasy show from, you know, based on a series of books by Lev Grossman called Magician. And I thought that was such a really cool concept. You know, it's sort of Harry Potter, but he's a little older. And, you know, he's in this sort of graduate university for magic. And there's this guy who's Dean Fogg, who's sort of the boss, you know, he's the head dean.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought it was such a great character. You know, typically a character like that, you know, you think of maybe Donald Sutherland, you know, you know what I mean? Like, you know, he would be great in it, you know, everything he does is great. You know, 65, 68 years old, you know, older white professor. But this, you know, you think of Dumbledore, something like that.
Right.
But this character, you know, they decided to offer me the role. And I said, I'll happily do that. But in the pilot, which we shot in New Orleans, which was fantastic. I'd actually never been there before in my whole life. And I had, on my days off, I made sure I hit the French Quarter. We had a great time shooting. And long story short, the dean dies at the end of the script. I said, "Well, you know, it's a great role. I'll do it anyway.
Right.
I will happily be in this. I love John. I love Sarah. Mm-hmm. Great. Pretty sure. Towards the end of my last 2 days of filming, they came up to me and asked me if I would be interested in maybe coming back for season one, if it got picked up for a series. I said, of course, yeah, it would, but I die in the pilot. How are you guys going to do that? And they said, well, we'll figure it out. It's magic. We'll figure it out.
Exactly.
Yeah, so they found a wonderful way to bring the dean back, and, you know, with these sort of enchanted sunglasses, which allow him to see just a tiny, tiny bit of maybe a bit of light or maybe the outline of someone's face, but that's all he could see. And we had to find a way to have the dean struggle with that and to have his magic, you know, his hands are demolished and he has to, and that takes a big part of his soul away, you know, like who he is as a man and as a human being. And as a magician. So my whole thing with season one was getting back my power and still trying to, you know, find a way to be, you know, the dean. And that was really all, you know, season one of the series, as you saw, is the discovery that, you know, Quentin Coldwater discovered that magic is real.
Right.
And, that not only is it real, but there's a place where you can learn it, you know, Brakefield University. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I thought it was such a really lovely idea, you know.
Yeah, and it's a great cast of very talented people, great writing,
very talented. Yeah.
You know, it's a nice blend of the special effects with the direction.
Right.
Just when you think it's going to turn one way, it turns left, which is kind of like part, which in part is the allure of the series itself. Yeah. But it makes sense.
Right.
It's not like they just make a shift. It makes sense, right?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Mm-hmm. And I really appreciate you talking about the dean and the character, because you can see that coming through, right? I mean,
yeah. Thank you. Yeah. It's for sure one of my. I think anyone who would have received this role, you know, anyone who would have had this role in their custody, they would have been just so happy, because there's so much you can do with the character like the dean. And I don't know what's in store for the dean. I know what's going to happen in season two, of course, but I don't know the longevity of the dean in terms of the series itself. Mm-hmm. All I can tell you is that I think people are going to really love season two, which premieres January 25th, I believe, on Sci-Fi Channel.
Yep.
And it will be...
Plug away.
It's going to be crazy. I'm going to plug it. It will be fillery, and it's going to be so intense and so
wow.
It's going to be like anything that it's going to be like watching. I saw some of the footage from one of the episodes, and it just looks like a dream, you know, on film.
Yeah, because you guys are acting. There's the directing, right? Director is telling you to act as if you are in this space, correct? And so scenes where you have a green screen or something like that, or blue screen,
right.
and that, so you guys don't see it until after they put everything together, correct?
Well, there is a, I mean, I would say yes and no. I mean, there is, yeah, because there is a, certainly part of a good deal of sort of the special effects, they have to, you know, do in post-production with CGI. You know, computer technology and, you know, green screen things. And, you know, you have to imagine that something is happening. Like, for example, in the pilot, you know, when the dean says, do some goddamn magic, and then Quentin's cards start, you know, it scares him, but that's the effect that you wanted. You wanted to scare the magic out of them.
Right.
And it worked, you know.
Right.
And it put Quentin in a mental place where he needs to be so that he can perform magic. So, and the cards fly all over the room. Well, when we were filming, and they, you know, land perfectly on the desk and do a perfect replica of the Brakeville's house.
Right.
And when we were shooting it, our director Mike Cahill, I believe it's spelled C-A-H-I-L-L, mm-hmm. Mike Cahill said, "Okay, I'm going to tell you guys what's happening, and we're going to keep the cameras rolling." So, okay, now the cards are flying over your head. Now they're flying to the right. Now they're flying to the left. Now they just landed, and now they have assembled into a perfect, you know, replica of the house. And so while he's saying all that, we're acting.
Right, right, right.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And then they do all this amazing stuff in post-production and put it all together. But we've been blessed, man, because a lot of the locations that we use are natural. Like for example, Fillory itself is, you know, there's a lot of wonderful places in Vancouver where there's, you know, forests and woods and things like that. And we've been able to get some great locations locked down.
Oh, wow. Okay.
You know, that serve that, you know, the locations
for
Fillory. And then they add in on top of that, you know,
right,
like the different things that they need, you know, and they do that in post-production. So some of the sets are really built, you know, like you'll see some of the things, like for example, where the kings and queens will be, where they reside, you know, in their kingdom, you know, mm-hmm. the thrones and the throne room and all that, that's all built. And it's when you walk into the set, mm-hmm. man, it knocks you out because it's so stunning, you know.
Wow.
And you that's when you know you have a good budget.
We said we got money up in here.
We got money.
Oh man. Listen, you know, as you know, Soulivity is all about you know, people aspiring to their dreams, and it's about supporting people with their dreams. And a couple of questions that I asked people who were interviewing. First question is, when you hear the word passion, what does that mean to you specifically?
Man, great. I love this question. It's a great question. And I've spoken with I've spoken with younger, you know, aspiring actors, and you know, mm-hmm. I went back to U of M maybe last January of 2015, I think mm-hmm. it was, or 2014, I can't remember, January, I think January 2014.
Right.
I can't remember, 2014, 2015, and right. Long story short, I think it was 2015, long story short, January 2014.
Gotcha.
I went back to U of M, and I spoke to, you know, the theater students there, and I invited. I said, I want anyone who is interested in hearing me speak, just please invite them. You know, and it was a good group of young folks. You know, bright eyed young folks. You know, mm-hmm. like we used to be.
Right.
And we still are.
Right. 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 Knock on wood.
Yeah. Exactly. You know, knock on wood. And I said to them, man, I said, there's one thing that makes for those of you who are thinking about going to, you know, to Hollywood, you know, Los Angeles, you know, and getting in the biz, as we call it. There's one thing that makes the biz go, makes the business move, and that makes it work, and it's passion.
Wow.
And you know, that's the one thing that anyone needs. You know, they have to have the desire and the passion to get a project going, you know, to get, you know, your Soulivity going,
right,
you know, to get the Magicians going. And it always comes down to that. I talked to Sarah Gamble and John McNamara,
mm-hmm.
and they said they believed in the Magician so much that they had to get the rights to the novel so that they can, you know, do something with it. And they stopped it around, but no one wanted to buy it.
Wow.
So they said, all right, shit, we'll come up with 50 grand and we'll do it ourselves.
Okay.
And that is passion, you
right.
know, and that's like, we're going to roll the dice on our own dime,
right,
you know, and we're going to write the script, and we're going to shoot it, and then we're going to sell it, and then hopefully someone will say, you know, that they like it.
Wow.
So, and that to me is really putting the ball putting your balls on the line and really having the passion for something. And I think that's a wonderful example of you know, what it takes to make Hollywood go round.
Really. Gotcha. Now the flip side of that, I look at this as two sides of the same coin. So you have passion on one side. What does purpose mean to you?
Say again?
What does purpose mean to you?
Purpose.
Yeah.
You mean like is it my purpose?
Yeah.
Man, that's a huge question. My purpose. I've said this before in other interviews. Mm-hmm. I haven't said it a lot. But I'll always say it if anyone asks me. But I've always believed that my purpose here on this earth at this time, you know, in this body, in this form that I'm in right now.
Yeah.
My purpose has been to is to be a working actor.
Yeah.
I look back when I was much younger, even before you and I met, you know, and I everything I wanted to do was sort of leading up to that, and I just didn't know it, you know.
Right.
And I never said I wanted to be a star. I never said I wanted to have a big house in the hills or anything like that. I just want to act.
Right.
And you know, that has been the thing that sort of kept me grounded and keeps me in the game. You know, like, you know, it's like I thought many times, like, well, if I wasn't acting, what would I do? You know, mm-hmm. and there have been a couple of times where, you know, I went bankrupt and I didn't have anything. And, you know, no one would have known it, you know, if they didn't ask.
Right.
But, a couple of really, really trying times, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, what am I here for? What am I supposed to do? You know, okay, well, this is what my purpose is. Is to be a working actor. I just need to get back on the road,
mm-hmm.
you know, and, mm-hmm. and get back on my path, you know. Mm-hmm. So, and, you know, all of that leads to bigger spiritual questions, of course. And God has been such an instrumental part of my life,
right?
And you know, and I'm grateful to God for everything that I have, man. You know, mm-hmm. I mean, my dog, my life, my family.
Yeah.
You know, you and I reconnecting, and you know what I mean, like, once I got that right, everything else sort of, you know, not easy, but you know, much easier.
Yeah, I mean, I know that, and people use the different terms. One common term that I've adopted for myself, and when people describe mm-hmm. it, is you're in the flow, right?
Yes.
So
yes.
Yeah. So yes. You know, you it appear uh-huh. you know you know what your passion is in terms of the drive mm-hmm. and the energy that's behind this, and you understood early on what your purpose was, because I've watched you. I mean, a lot of people don't realize that. I mean, after University of Michigan, when you graduated from there in 1990, mm-hmm. you decided, I'm gone. I'm going to Chicago, and I remember the phone call. A lot of people don't know a lot of this. That you decided and you follow your heart and your dream, and shortly thereafter, you know, that started bearing fruit. You know, everybody has to go through growth opportunities and that kind of thing to go to their next level, but. I really see that you, and I really appreciate you sharing this time with us and your story, because I think it's important for people to hear. Well,
yeah, thank you, brother, and likewise, man. I mean, you know, I'm so proud of you, man. There's so much. Like, I want to redo this whole interview this time. I want to ask all the questions.
We hope that you have enjoyed our personal interview with Rick Worthy, the Dean of Magic. We really want to thank Rick for allowing us to share his personal story with the Soulivity community. Please stay tuned for future interviews with people just like each of you, learning to live their lives with passion and with purpose. Until then, we wish all of you light, love, and good living.